Hello everyone, my name is Marcia Pierce. I'm the Director of Solutions Architecture here at Pure Storage. And today with me is
Anthony Nocentino, Principal Food Solution Architect here at Pure Storage.
And today we're going to be talking about database high availability and how you can use storage-based replication to give you some high availability solutions. So let's talk about, right, we've talked earlier about how we can augment application level replication with storage and make some of those things better. But there are scenarios where people might not want to do application level replication anymore, right?
Right.
And use storage-based replication. So we're going to discuss one of those. And I think this is one that a lot of people have heard about over the years, if you listen to a lot of bloggers. But the really kind of common thing that we hear a lot of times from customers is your skill set or your staff level, right?
Right.
Because application level replication is great. You get a lot of cool features with it. But if you're that lone DBA out there, right?
You'd have to learn the replication topologies or techniques for each of the different data platforms you have to support.
Right. And understand how networking and all of that affects them.
Right.
And so that's where also the skill set and how long you've been a DBA and what your experience level is really kind of matters.
Absolutely.
Right. So those are some of the scenarios where we can do something simpler. What can we do simpler if you're in that kind of scenario?
Sure. So let's look at how we implement storage replication inside of FlashArray for a database platform. So if I have a system, right, like a database that I want to deploy in a highly available way, we can deploy that inside of FlashArray, right? And traditionally what we do is we'd set up what's called some sort of storage-based cluster, right? If you're in the Windows universe, this would be a failover cluster instance, right? And so you'd have nodes that would connect to your FlashArray in a redundant way, and the database would be a single database inside of the FlashArray that's shared amongst the nodes inside of that particular FlashArray. Now, this is a fault domain here, and so if we wanted to protect against that fault domain, we need to replicate that data somewhere else. And so what you can see folks do most commonly is replicate that data to another storage subsystem. In this case, we're going to talk about FlashArray. And so what we would do with a technology called Active Cluster is we'd stretch this volume with a technique called a pod to another FlashArray. And so what would happen now is that database is available in both of the FlashArrays. We could then go and connect those nodes to that other FlashArray. And so now I have a fully redundant copy of my database in two different arrays serviced by two different nodes in some sort of clustering way. Now, if we do have a failure here, right, what's going to happen is this particular storage path would go away and this particular storage path would go away. But Marcia, what would happen to my database if I had a failure of that device there?
Nothing.
Nothing. Right, because what's going to happen at the operating system level is if we're using Microsoft technologies, a technology called MPIO, it's just going to redirect the IO to that other FlashArray. And so that system that's running on top of that replicated storage platform isn't going to experience a downtime. The IOs will just get redirected to the other array. And what does that mean to me as a DBA when I have to fail over my application? Nothing happened there, right? I just keep going, even independent of that failure, right, Marcia?
So did I have to do anything as a DBA?
No. And so that goes back to your skill set point, right? This doesn't become a specialized operation. It just works under the hood based on the storage topology inside of your environment.
So that's one of those automagic things that kind of happen.
It's automagic.
I like that, right? Because the other things require some kind of user intervention oftentimes.
Right.
And so anything that can happen without anybody having to get up in the middle of the night to make a decision is going to make everybody's life easier, especially if you don't have a large staff.
Right.
So the other thing that I see that sometimes people kind of deal with is that they're doing application level replication.
Mm-hmm.
They've got the skill set in their environment, but what they have maybe is a legacy application, right?
Okay.
Because in order for you to take advantage of that application level replication, a lot of times you have to do things like have the application itself recognize multi-subnet listeners or different things in your database that your database is doing.
Right, like identifying the read-write copy, things like that. Right,
right. Right. Yep. So there's all of those things that have to happen. And sometimes there are applications that we don't build that we've gotten from a vendor,
right
that they have made decisions that we are impacted by, but we want a high available solution.
Right. So when you're comparing and contrasting high availability architectures for your platform, looking at a storage-based technique means when I'm going to consume the data services of this particular database, I'm just going to consume that database, right? I don't have to understand where the read-write copy is because where that is inside the storage subsystem is isolated for me as a consumer of that data. So I just point my application at the database and consume the data. And it's the underlying storage subsystem and the underlying clustering technologies that'll expose that database to me in the simplest way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So a lot of times when we're discussing architectural decisions with customers, mm-hmm. we're like, do application level replication where you can.
Right.
And where it's not supported, do something like this.
Correct.
One of the reasons that people tend to do application level replication oftentimes mm-hmm. is they want to scale out their reads.
Right.
So how can we help somebody scale out their reads if they're not doing application level replication?
Sure. So leveraging the active cluster technology that we introduced so far today and leveraging MPIO, if all of these paths are available to me across both of these arrays, writes will go down one path into one array and be replicated between the two, but reads actually can be serviced from both arrays, right? And so I can get the read capacity of both of these arrays to service my workload, right?
That's pretty cool.
That is pretty cool.
Because, you know, the other reason why, so we talked about, sorry, I'm behind here. We talked about scaling out reads, right? Okay. That was one of the things that people want to do. But the other thing, the reason why that somebody may choose to do storage-based replication,
sure.
right? What is that thing that we're all worried about? It's cost, right?
Right.
Your licensing cost, because application level replication is not free. Right. It usually costs money for those advanced data services, regardless of your vendor.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that you get from the application level replication a lot of times is scalable reads.
Right.
So how do we help out with the licensing?
Sure. So since we're replicating at the storage tier, again, we're going to have a simpler configuration at the data tier. And so most vendors that have some sort of application level replication, well, they're going to charge you for that. And they're also going to charge you that most likely per replica that you want to have involved. In this scenario here, it's just going to be one license to support the failover clustering that you would need to have your application be highly available.
Very cool.
I think,
you know, especially I work with a lot of customers overseas mm-hmm. who have smaller data sets
right.
and they are not interested in doing some of the more advanced licensing.
Mm-hmm.
And this is something that you see a lot of times people doing overseas,
right.
having used different kinds of active cluster technology from different vendors. Mm-hmm. I've used them myself in the past. Usually pretty complicated.
Yes.
And this is very, very simple.
It's definitely simple.
We definitely believe in the KISS methodology here, right? Keep
right.
things as simple as possible. So the other thing that I talk about when you're making those decisions to do application level replication, and mm-hmm. I've been affected by both of these myself,
okay.
is network. And there's two ends to the network equation. One of them could be that you're really running a high performant workload, right?
Right.
That is exceeding the capabilities of what your application level replication is doing,
mm-hmm.
right? And so you're sending so much that it just really can't keep up and it's going across your network and impacting
right.
other things.
Mm-hmm.
The other scenario is that maybe you're not doing that much, but you do not have a properly designed network.
Right.
And so any kind of network impacts mm-hmm. are going to constantly cause your application to fail over and have performance issues. And so maybe taking that off the network might be a good idea. So let's talk about how we help customers in that scenario.
Sure. So we're looking at both networking and performance. Let's talk about the types of replication that you'd see at the application tier. First off, statement, right? So statement level replication means if I execute an insert or an update or delete against a primary replica, that same exact statement's going to replicate to all of the other replicas in the environment. And so that's going to have some performance characteristics to it, right, Marcia? In that each of the instances or replicas involved in that replication topology have to absorb that entire statement and all of the performances associated with that, all the way from the application level down into the storage tier, right? So that's the first type.
Well, and also, let's just kind of click into that
sure.
statement level replication. There are things that your users can do as well that can impact that statement level replication, right?
Right.
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 Yeah. So certain operations can actually block replication both at the statement level and logical level too. So when we talk about logical level, that's moving some sort of application level structure that's a little bit further down from statement, maybe some sort of like log block or some sort of file structure inside of your application. And as Marcia indicated, there are scenarios that can be blocked. And there's some performance considerations around that because each of the replicas that's involved in this type of replication topology still has to read that physical structure and apply it to the other replicas in my environment. So that also has some interesting performance characteristics with it too.
Right. It's more efficient than statement level replication.
Right.
But it still has those capabilities of being impacted, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're also replicating still all of your writes.
Correct. Writes, reads, Writes.
Writes. Writes. Only writes.
All right. So let's look at another type of replication. We're going to look at block level replication. And so block level replication is going to relieve the operating system and also the actual database engine itself from the work or the responsibility of replicating that data between all of the replicas that are associated with it. And that has some pretty significant performance impacts because that database engine can go on doing database level work, not doing replication level work. And more importantly, at the network level, we're going to be sending the minimal amount of data between the replicas because of the replication technologies that Pure has are data reduced. So Marcia, you want to talk about that in a little more detail?
Well, yeah. So now you've got that 3.8:1 data reduction going between those, right? It's those dedupe compressed blocks that are going between those two arrays. So now you've lowered how much traffic is being sent.
Right.
Also, you've lowered the amount of CPU and processing time that you're doing at the application layer,
right,
which comes back to this licensing cost as well.
Right.
Again.
So our platform can go on service and user workload, not maintaining the replication topology.
Right.
Right.
So we're just kind of keeping everything a little bit more simple.
Yes.
So these are some of the ways that we can help our customers take maybe a more complex application level replication and use some storage-based technologies to give them very similar capabilities and improve their licensing costs, their network utilization, maybe support legacy applications and support maybe some of their skill sets or their staff who aren't used to dealing with those types of things.
Absolutely.
Right. I think this is very useful information for DBAs, and thank you for joining us today. And we look forward to talking to you about other cool things we can do for databases.